Welcome back to Chemistry Matters. In the first video of this playlist, you learned that reactions that are reversible reach a state of equilibrium when the rate of the forward reaction equals the rate of the reverse reaction. You also learned that the ratio of products to reactants at equilibrium depends in part on the relative activation energies of the forward and reverse reactions. In this video, we'll learn how to calculate the ratio of products to reactants at equilibrium, as well as the specific concentrations of reactants and products under a certain set of conditions. You've seen how the ratio of products to reactants depends in part on activation energies and temperature. Scientists use a mathematical expression to quantify this ratio. The ratio of products to reactants at equilibrium is represented by a value called the equilibrium constant, KEQ. The equilibrium constant is the ratio of the concentrations of products divided by the concentrations of reactants. Every reaction has its own KEQ value, which is a specific constant at a specific temperature. Knowing the equilibrium constant for a chemical reaction tells us information about the extent and therefore efficiency of the reaction. We can predict how efficient a reaction will be before it happens. For example, if the equilibrium constant of a reaction is very high, formation of products is highly favored. If the equilibrium constant is lower than desired, chemists can suggest ways to improve product formation. If you're in the business of producing chemicals for sale, the efficiency of a reaction is very important. The production of ammonia, sulfuric acid, and methanol are examples of products that are maximized in industry by adjusting conditions such as concentration, temperature, and pressure using knowledge about the equilibrium constant. With that in mind, let's go back to our classroom to learn more about this topic.
Notice in the equation for KEQ that the concentrations of the products and the reactants have the exponents A, B, C, and D. And these exponents match the coefficients from the balanced equation. So the higher a coefficient would be in the balanced equation, the greater the effect that that substance is going to have on the equilibrium constant. And one thing that's important to note is we will not include pure substances in our equilibrium expression. So that means solids or pure liquids will not be included when we write these. Okay, the reason being is solutions, which if you'll remember, consist of solutes that are dissolved in solvents, and gases, they can have variable compositions, whereas pure substances do not. So that's why we omit them from the equilibrium expression. So let's see if we can write some equilibrium expressions and eventually determine constants for some actual reactions, okay? So as you can see on the monitor, I've worked out the first example for you. And let's go through that together, and then you guys can work with your partner and come up with an equilibrium expression for the next reaction, okay? So if you'll notice in this example here, the concentration of methanol, which is the product, it is found in the numerator of the expression. And you'll also notice that since in the balanced equation, methanol has a coefficient of 1, that is the same thing that is the exponent in the expression. So there's this understood 1 as a superscript there for methanol. And when we consider the reactants, so we have carbon monoxide and hydrogen, you'll notice in the equilibrium expression, those are found in the denominator. And it's the same thing. The coefficients are going to be placed as exponents once you transfer it to the equilibrium expression. And so that's why for hydrogen, for example, there's a 2 as a coefficient, and we find in the equilibrium expression that we have a 2 as the exponent. Okay? So now let's work together with your partner, and you guys are going to determine what the equilibrium expression is for this next reaction. So this reaction of hydrogen plus nitrogen to get into an equilibrium with ammonia is known as the Haber process. And the Haber process is a very important industrial chemical reaction as it's responsible for producing almost 500 million tons of ammonia each year. It's such an important reaction that Fritz Haber, who was the one who actually formulated this reaction, was awarded the Nobel Prize for it.
We've got the finished reaction right here.
Okay, great. Austin, would you like to share with us what you got?
Yes. So we put the product, NH3, or ammonia, on the top. And then we put nitrogen and hydrogen on the bottom because they're reactants. And then we gave them exponents that match their coefficients in the chemical equation.
Perfect. Does anybody else have anything to add to that?
That's what we got. I have a question, though. How did we figure out the actual value of KEQ?
Okay, I'm glad that you asked that, because so far what we've done is we've determined the equilibrium expression. But to actually calculate the value for K, we're going to need to know the concentrations of all substances in the equation, reactants and products, but we need to know their equilibrium concentrations. And once we have that, then we can calculate the value of K.
Picking up on what our teacher just said, I want to invite you to watch the Closer Look video for Unit 10, which explains how to perform equilibrium calculations. This video will allow you to practice this very important aspect of chemistry. So we'll take a break from the Unit 10 playlist here, so you have the opportunity to watch that video and become more familiar with this equilibrium calculation. And I'll see you at the top of the next video on the Unit 10 playlist.